Hello everybody, I'm Elena Pinetti, PhD student at the University of Torino and at the Sorbonne University. My research interests are dark matter searches, and today I will present the integral X-ray constraints on subgiving dark matter. This talk is based on this paper on which I worked together with Marco Cirelli and Nicola Fornengo, are my two PhD advisors, and Bradley Kavanagh, who is currently a postdoc at the IFCA in Spain. So in the title of our paper, we refer to subgiving dark matter. And just to fix an idea in mind, we mean dark matter particles with a mass between 1 MeV and 5 GeV. In the following, first of all, I will give a brief introduction on dark matter searches with photons, then I will introduce the key elements that we need in order to compute dark matter flux, then I will talk about the X-ray data that we used in our analysis, and finally, I will present our constraints with and without astrophysical background. So the dark matter in the universe is observed to be present on different scales, in our galaxy, in the satellite galaxies of the Milky Way, in the cluster of galaxies, and in the cosmic web. In our analysis, we focus on the Milky Way. So the indirect detection of dark matter searches relies on the idea that dark matter particles can annihilate or decay and produce a huge variety of astrophysical messengers that we can detect with our telescopes. Particularly, the astrophysical messengers that we expect are photons, neutrinos, and charged cosmic rays. And in our analysis, we focus on photons from annihilating dark matter. When dealing with photon searches from subgiving dark matter, one has to deal with the MeV gap. Particularly, this plot shows you the sensitivity as a function of the energy for several experiments. You see that in this energy window between 1 MeV and 100 of MeV, there is a scarcity of experiments compared to other energy range. So people in the community are trying to find alternative ways to study dark matter candidates with a mass in this range. What we propose in our work is that subgiving dark matter can produce photons with an energy much lower with respect to their mass. And in particular, this thanks to the inverse quantum scattering, as I will explain, and this contribution fall in the energy range covered by the integral SPA data. So we can study subgiving dark matter by using the data of the integral detector. In our analysis, we focus on three annihilation channels: electron, muon, and pion. Each of these channels is kinematically open whenever the mass m chi of the dark matter particle is above the mass of the electron, muon, and pion, depending on the channel under consideration. So what are the main components and the main contribution to the total flux? Well, let's consider, for instance, two dark matter particles which annihilate into muons. These muons can radiate a photon, and this is the final state radiation. But they can also decay, and the W boson or the positron can radiate a photon as well, and this is the radiative decay emission. Final state radiation and radiative decay are the so-called Prong components. And then there are the secondary components, the inverse quantum scattering, on which I will say a few words in a minute, because this is the focus of our analysis. So now let's see one by one of the differential flux related to the three components of the total flux. So the differential flux of the final state radiation depends on the particle properties of the dark matter particles, so mass and annihilation cross-section. It also depends on the energy spectrum in two photons and on the J factor. The J factor is the integral over the line of sight of the square dark matter density distribution, squared because we focus on annihilating dark matter. For the muon and the pion channel, we have also the radiative decay emission. The differential flux for the radiative decay is the same of the final state radiation. One is just to replace the energy spectrum with the proper one. Now, coming to the protagonist of our work, the inverse quantum scattering. Let me quickly recall the physical process under consideration. So we have dark matter particles which annihilate and they can produce pairs of electrons and positrons. These electrons and positrons propagate in our galaxy and can interact with the low energy photons in the Milky Way. We consider three kinds of photons: EMB, infrared light from dust, and optical starlight. What happens is that these electrons and positrons scatter and transfer part of their energy on the low energy photons, which therefore will become X-rays. Now, the final energy of the photons after the inverse quantum scattering can be approximated as 4 gamma square E zero, where gamma is the Lorentz factor and E zero is the initial energy of the photon. Now we want to study subgiving dark matter, so we imagine that these subgiving dark matter particles will produce electrons with an energy as given in this third column of this table. 5G electron that interact with a CMB photon for inverse scattering will produce a final photon with an energy of 40 keV. If we want to study more intermediate Dermatter masses, we imagine that they would give rise to 0.5 GeV electron. This could interact with an infrared photon and produce a final photon with an energy of 40 keV. If we want to study lower Dermatter particles, they would produce, for instance, an electron with an energy of 50 MeV. This can scatter the optical starlight up to energy of 400 keV. So we see that after the inverse quantum scattering, these low energy radiation fields become hard X-rays and soft gamma rays. And more importantly, this energy range is covered by the integral data. Now, the differential flux of the inverse quantum scattering can be expressed in terms of the emissivity. The emissivity depends on two key elements, the differential power into photons and the electron number density. This factor 2 in front of everything reminds us that annihilation events of Dermatter particles produce an equal population of electrons and positrons, and so this doubles the emissivity. Now, in this figure, I show you the inverse quantum scattering power as a function of the final photon energy in a location that corresponds to our solar system. The different curves refer to different input energy of the electrons. And for input energy of the electrons of 10 GeV, I also show you the different contribution for the three interstellar radiation fields, CMB, infrared, and optical starlight, that we consider in our analysis. Now, let's consider, for instance, a 1 GeV electrons. These do inverse quantum scattering on the interstellar radiation fields in our galaxy and will produce photons with an energy between, let's say, 1 electron volt up to 100 mega electron volt in this plot. But most of the photons will have a final energy corresponding to the peak of the power, so around 30 MeV. The point is that we see that this black arrow shows you the integral window. And so we already see that our technique with the integral data will be particularly suitable to study Dermatter particles with a mass above 100 MeV. Now, the second element that we need in order to compute the emissivity is the electron number density. This depends on the source storm, which in turn depends on the particle properties, on the energy spectrum into electrons and positrons, and on density distribution squared. And the second key element that we need is the energy loss parameter. So we include in our analysis four kinds of energy losses: ionization, Bremsstrahlung, inverse quantum scattering, and synchrotron emission. In this plot, I show you the energy loss coefficient as a function of the electron and positron energy in two different locations. In the first plot, a location on the gravitic plane, in a spot near the solar system. We see that in this case, the total energy losses are dominated by ionization and Bremsstrahlung. And this is not surprising because on the gravitic plane we have a lot of gas, and so the interactions with gas are favored. If instead we go outside of the gravitic plane, like 4 kiloparsec above the galactic center, which is quite far from the gravitic plane, we see that above 40 MeV, the inverse quantum scattering becomes the dominant contribution to the total energy losses. So we already see that in our analysis we would prefer to stay outside of the galactic plane. Now, in our analysis, we considered the data of the Integral Space Telescope, which is an ESA mission operational between 2003 and 2009. It covers an energy range between 20 keV up to 8 MeV, so hard X-rays and soft gamma rays, which is precisely what we need. The integral data are provided in two different forms. They are provided as a photon spectra in a rectangular region in the sky that includes also the galactic plane. And this plot shows you the energy flux as a function of the final photon energy. So the signal in the total signal is displayed in black and refers to Dermatter particles with a mass of 150 MeV, which annihilate into muons. So we see that they produce a signal in gamma rays, which fall shortly before the Fermi data, but they also produce a signal in X-rays, which overlap with the integral data. Let me also point out that in this case, both the final state radiation and the radiative decay fall well below the integral data. Therefore, in this case, including the inverse quantum component is crucial, since it is the limiting contribution to the total flux, and therefore it will bend to stronger constraints. On the second panel, we have the case of lower Dermatter masses, only 10 MeV, which annihilate into electrons and positrons. This case is better constrained by the final state radiation. And the reason is that the inverse quantum scattering for these lower metal masses peaks at energies which are much lower than the integral window. And the point is that in our analysis we want to stay outside of the graph plane, and therefore, for this reason, we decide to use the other dataset provided by the integral collaboration, which is the angular profile, as a function of the latitude beams. This dataset is divided into 5 different energy bands, 27 keV up to 1.8 MeV. Each of these energy bands includes 21 beams in latitude, except the highest energy band, which includes only 15 latitude beams. In this plot, I show you the angular flux as a function of the latitude for the 100-200 keV energy band. The green points refer to the integral data, while the black points refer to our theoretical prediction estimated for the metal particles with a mass of 150 MeV, which are neither two muons. We see that the metal flux becomes larger as we approach the central latitude beams, because the metal density is larger as we approach the galactic plane. The very central latitude beams is much lower instead, and this is due to the fact that this beam corresponds to lines of sight which cross the galactic plane, where we have a lot of gas, so our electrons and positrons will lose energies in another way, and the inverse quantum signal will be suppressed. In order to stay outside of the galactic plane, in our analysis, we mask these central latitude beams. In this slide, I show you the angular profile in the other 4 energy bands that we consider in our analysis. So the color points are the data, and the black points, as in the previous slide, refers to their metal particles with a mass of 150 MeV, muon channel, and annihilation cross-section on the bound. Now, coming to the constraints that we obtain in our analysis, here I show you the constraints on the velocity average annihilation cross-section as a function of the dark matter mass. For the 3 channels, so in green, electron channel, in blue, the muon channel, in pink, the pion channel. The 3 different line style refers to the different constraints that we obtain separately by considering separately different components to the total flux. So the solid line refers to the constraints that we obtain by considering only the inverse quantum signal, dashed line only the radiative decay, dotted line only final state radiation. And we see that when present, the inverse quantum scattering typically provides the best constraints. And this is due to the fact that for larger metal masses, the inverse quantum signal is the dominant contribution to the total flux. But for lower metal masses, below 20-30 MeV, the final state radiation better constrains the cross-section. But this consideration affects only the electron channel, since it is the only one kinematically open for these lower metal masses. And in this slide, I show you the overall 2-sigma constraints that we obtain by considering the total flux, so the inverse quantum plus final state radiation plus radiative decay, by considering all the data points. So we combine all the 5 energy bands and we combine all the angular beams. And we compare our results with the other existing constraints in the literature. In particular, in 2013, Essig et al. Derived their constraints by considering several datasets of X-ray and gamma-ray experiments. Among these channels, they focus on the electron channel. In their analysis, they consider only the final state radiation component. Our constraints are comparable for lower metal masses, then they do better thanks to the control data, and you see that for larger metal masses, including the inverse quantum component, makes a significant difference, make a huge improvement. Then we have Budo et al. In 2017, they study subject with dark matter by considering the local measurements, the measurements of Voyager on the local flux of electrons and positrons. They focus on the electron and the muon channel. And finally, we have the CMB constraints, which are of 2 types, S-wave and P-wave for the electron and the muon channel. We see that if the matter annihilation is speed independent, so S-wave, CMB constraints are quite strong along the entire mass window of interest. However, if the matter annihilation instead is P-wave, so it scales with the square of the velocity, then the CMB constraint relax quite a lot along the entire mass window of interest. So let me stress on the fact that if dark matter annihilation is a P-wave, our constraints are the strong at present time in the literature for dark matter masses between 150 MeV and 1.5 GeV. So far, we have considered, we have tried to explain the integral data by considering only a dark matter contribution. But we know that in a realistic scenario, we also have a contribution of astrophysical origin. Now, the main component to the astrophysical background is related to the diffuse inverse quantum scattering, because we have active galactic nuclei, supernova remnants, for instance, that can produce electrons and positrons, and these electrons and positrons can do inverse quantum scattering on the low energy photons in our galaxy and mimic our dark matter signal. Clearly, if one consider also the astrophysical background, the space and the room for exotic physics is reduced, and this will bring to stronger constraints. As we see in this last slide, where I show you the constraints on the cross-section as a function of the dark matter mass in two cases. So the conservative case, which corresponds to the thick line, is the one that I showed you before. So if we consider only the dark matter contribution. While the optimistic constraints, which is this less thick line, refers to the case in which we also take into account a template for the astrophysical background. And we see that there is an improvement of 60%. So to conclude, the main point of our analysis are that we focus on sub-GV dark matter, so the mass between 1 MeV up to 5 GeV. We consider three annihilation channels, electron, muon, and pion. The key point of our analysis is that we include the inverse quantum scattering between the electrons and positrons of dark matter origin with the low energy radiation fields in our galaxy. We compare our theoretical prediction for the dark matter flux with the X-ray data from the Integral Space Telescope. We derive our bounds, and in particular, if dark matter annihilation is a P-wave, we derive the strongest bounds at present time in the literature for dark matter masses with a mass between 150 MeV and 1.5 GeV. And with this, I conclude. I thank all of you for your attention, and a special thanks to the organizer for this nice opportunity to talk today. Bye!